Viruses are just about everywhere on Earth, and most of them infect bacteria. These are called bacteriophages, or phages for short, and there are an estimated 10 to the power of 31 phages on Earth. That's 10 nonillion of them. A typical phage particle is roughly 100 nanometers in diameter. That's 1/1000th the thickness of a sheet of paper. All 10 nonillion of the phages on Earth laid end to end would be 100 million light years long. That's 40 times the distance to the nearest galaxy, Andromeda. Phages have been called microbial dark matter, because despite their staggering abundance, we know so little about how they interact with the biosphere and with us, though we know it must be incredibly significant. A deeper understanding of phages has implications for treating antibiotic-resistant infections, as well as understanding the global carbon cycle and our own biology. Given the abundance of phages, it shouldn't be surprising that they exhibit incredible diversity in size, structure, and niche. The most well-known and well-studied phages are those which infect E. coli, like the T4 phage, which have the iconic lunar lander shape. Some of these phages, like the T4 phage, don't use cytosine in their DNA, the C in the genetic code, but instead use a modified cytosine molecule called 5-hydroxymethylcytosine, which serves the same purpose, but potentially evolved to evade the DNA-cutting enzymes called restriction enzymes that bacteria use as part of their immune system. Restriction enzymes have evolved to cut DNA with a precise sequence only found in foreign DNA, and over 3,000 restriction enzymes are known, each of which recognizes a unique sequence or cuts the DNA in a different way. Purified restriction enzymes are indispensable tools that allow molecular biologists to cut DNA at specific sequences, which is useful for linking multiple DNA molecules. In addition to T4 and similar phages which have a head, tail, and fibers, there are phages that look like just a head section, and filamentous phages that look like spaghetti. Regardless of the shape, the protein shell that encloses the viral genetic material, either DNA or RNA, is called the capsid. In the case of the T4 phage, that's the head, and it's the middle section in the case of filamentous phages. The size of that genome inside the phage capsid ranges from 3 kilobase pairs to almost 500 kilobase pairs, with the median being around 45 kilobase pairs. Compare that with the median bacterial genome size of 3 megabase pairs, and our own genome of around 6 gigabase pairs. To put that in perspective, in binary, one byte, composed of 8 bits, can encode 4 base pairs, since we need 2 bits to represent each possible A, T, G, or C. Therefore, we could encode the genome of the median phage in 11.2 kilobytes, which is the file size of this JPEG. And yes, a kilobyte is 1,000 bytes, not 1024, because technically that's a kibabyte. That genetic material is packed incredibly tightly inside the capsid. In the case of DNA phages, a molecular motor protein binds the phage DNA and forces it into the capsid when it's produced. DNA is negatively charged, so it repels itself, and it has elasticity like a spring that resists compression. Packed into the capsid by the motor protein, the DNA exerts a pressure of around 50 atmospheres. That's the same pressure you would feel 490 meters underwater. A phage first infects a bacteria by injecting its pressurized genetic material into it. From there, the phage can enter the lytic cycle, where it uses the bacterial machinery to make and assemble new phages, roughly 20 to 100 per bacteria, then causes the bacteria to burst, or lyse, releasing new phages which go off and infect more bacteria. Alternatively, the phage can enter a state of dormancy called the lysogenic cycle, where it integrates its genome into the bacteria's genome. As the bacteria divides, it passes the phage DNA onto all its descendants. When conditions are right, the phage can reactivate and switch to the lytic cycle. Phages were first described in 1915 by the English bacteriologist Frederick Twert, who described a microscopic entity capable of forming plaques, dead zones formed where the phage lysed bacteria growing on a petri plate. But it was the French microbiologist Félix Durel who recognized that the phenomenon was due to a virus which he called bacteriophages. Durel quickly realized the potential of phages as a therapy for bacterial disease and worked to develop it. He had early successes treating small outbreaks of dysentery and cholera with phages, but attempts to develop phage therapy commercially were largely a failure, as the complexity of consistent phage production proved too difficult. In the early 1940s, penicillin became widely available. Antibiotics like penicillin are easy to produce and administer, they're shelf-stable, and extremely effective against a wide range of pathogens. As a result, interest in phage therapy largely dried up in the US, though it continued in the Soviet Union, where phage therapies were implemented to treat and prevent gangrene, typhoid fever, staphylococcal infections, and cholera, with varying degrees of success. The emergence of antibiotic-resistant bacteria has led to a resurgence of interest in phage therapies in the West, and several phage cocktails have recently entered clinical trials in the US targeting the bacteria Staphylococcus aureus and Pseudomonas arginosa. Bacteria have been in an evolutionary arms race with phages for millions of years, so it seems while bacteria may evolve resistance to one or even many phages, they will never evolve broad resistance to all phages like we see with multi-drug-resistant bacteria. One striking example of this is the case of UC San Diego professor Tom Patterson, who in 2015 contracted a pancreatic infection of a multi-drug-resistant strain of Acinetobacter baumannii while traveling in Egypt with his wife. Although the infection initially appeared to respond to some antibiotics, it quickly developed resistance to everything. Soon the bacteria entered his bloodstream, leading to septic shock, which sent Patterson into a coma. His wife, Stephanie Strathdy, was the chief of the Division of Global Public Health at UC San Diego at the time, and recruited scientists from the U.S. Navy Medical Research Center, Biological Defense Research Directorate, Texas A&M, and a biotech company to develop a phage therapy that would target her husband's infection. After multiple rounds of phage therapy in conjunction with antibiotics, Patterson awoke from the coma and cleared the infection. So how are these therapeutic phages made? Here's how it works in the simplest case. First, a sample that contains a lot of phages is collected from nature. Phages need bacterial hosts, so environments with a lot of bacteria are the place to look. Sewage and soil have tons of bacteria, and many of the bacteria found there are pathogenic in humans, so it's the perfect place to look for phages that target them. Next, the sample is filtered and purified to remove bacteria, debris, and other contaminants while keeping the phages. Then we grow the bacteria we're interested in targeting on a nutrient agar plate until it forms a film called a lawn. We pour some of the diluted phage sample on the lawn and wait for plaques to appear. Those plaques, or dead spots, contain the phages that successfully infected and lysed the target cell. We can sample them and grow them in larger batches to be used as therapy. With modern molecular biology, we can take the extra steps of sequencing and selectively mutating the promising phages to tailor their characteristics as needed. But even if you've never received a dose of phages as a therapy, there are trillions of them in and on your body right now, on your skin, in your lungs, and in your gut. They're part of the human virome, and they seem to play an important role in health and disease. Your body is made up of about 30 trillion human cells and 30 trillion bacterial cells. The number of viruses is harder to quantify, but it's somewhere between 3 and 300 trillion viruses, most of which are phages. By cell count, erythrocytes, red blood cells, make up about 84% of your body. Not surprising, given they're one of the smallest cells and your body is full of blood. Adipocytes, fat cells, and muscle cells make up just 0.2 and 0.001% of the cell counts respectively. But adipocytes and muscle cells make up 28% and 43% of all your cells by mass respectively, owing to their comparatively large volume. Back to the trillions of phages throughout your body and mine. The phages in our gut seem to be decidedly more lysogenic than lytic, mostly lying dormant, allowing their DNA to be replicated inside the host bacteria, only occasionally destroying the host to produce more phages. By contrast, aquatic phages are highly lytic. More on them later. The fact that the majority of phages in our gut are lysogenic has some interesting implications. Lysogenic phages can convey superinfection immunity to our gut bacteria. That's when bacteria, already infected by a lysogenic phage, may be immune to infection by lytic phages that would otherwise destroy them. When a phage integrates into the host genome, it doesn't just bring the genes that encode the phage itself. It can also carry a number of genetic elements that modify the bacteria's behavior. One class, called auxiliary metabolic genes, or AMGs, alter the bacterial metabolism to benefit the phage's reproduction. For example, AMGs can redirect energy in the bacteria to processes that make nucleotides, the building blocks of DNA, to ensure the maximum number of phages can be produced when it enters the lytic cycle. Additionally, phages can enhance the virulence of the bacteria in a process called lysogenic conversion. Here, the additional genes carried by the phage can be toxins, which can transform otherwise harmless bacteria into dangerous pathogens. For example, cholera is an infection caused by the bacteria Vibrio cholerae, which is spread by consuming food or water contaminated by feces containing the bacteria. Cholera causes severe watery diarrhea that leads to a potentially lethal dehydration and electrolyte imbalance. The diarrhea also serves to spread the infection if it contaminates food or water supplies. Without proper treatment, mortality is as high as 50%, and cholera kills 20,000 to 140,000 people annually. But not all Vibrio cholerae bacteria can cause cholera. The symptoms of the disease are due to a protein the bacteria produces called cholera toxin, but the bacteria can only produce the toxin if it's been infected by a phage, specifically the CTX phage. The CTX phage brings the gene for the cholera toxin with it when it infects the bacteria and integrates into its genome. The bacteria starts secreting the cholera toxin, which enters the cells in the intestine and starts a cascade that causes intestinal cells to pump out large amounts of chloride ions into the intestine. The osmotic pressure of the chloride draws water into the intestine, leading to diarrhea. By turning a harmless Vibrio cholerae bacteria into a highly transmissible disease, the CTX phage spreads itself and its host. Botulism, diphtheria, and scarlet fever are similarly the result of lysogenic conversion of relatively harmless bacteria into dangerous pathogens. Clearly, phages can greatly influence our bacterial microbiome and our health generally. Maybe in the future, we'll be able to monitor our microbiome by sequencing the phages in our gut or adjust its composition by introducing beneficial phages. Either way, there's a lot left to learn about how they interact with our body. There's also a lot to learn about how they interact with broader ecosystems. About half of all phages on Earth are in the ocean. I mentioned earlier that aquatic phages tend to be primarily lytic. In fact, marine phages kill around 20% of marine bacteria every day, which significantly affects the way carbon, nitrogen, and phosphorus flow through the marine food chain. This phenomenon is called viral shunt. Bacteria are eaten by microzooplankton, which are in turn eaten by larger zooplankton, and so on up the food chain, carrying the organic matter with it. By lysing bacteria, phages release the organic material back into a dissolved state where it becomes available for new bacteria to consume. This nutrient recycling helps stimulate the growth of other bacteria, such as photosynthetic picoplankton, which are key drivers of the carbon cycle and form the base of the marine food web. There's much more to be said on the subject of phages, and even more that's yet to be discovered, but I'll leave it here for today. I'll put the titles and DOIs of the sources in the video description if you want to dig deeper. Some of them are freely accessible on PubMed, and if they aren't, you can access them by pasting the DOI into Sci-Hub. Disseminating knowledge is a public good. Do your part. Thanks for watching.